Around 1600, Luigi Zenobi famously wrote that the best trombonists were judged by their grace, by the imitation of a boy's voice, in the choiceness and variety of diminutions, in the graceful manner of holding the instrument, in not contorting the body while playing, and in many other things. Over 400 years have passed since Zenobi penned those words, and performance practice has inevitably evolved. Renaissance and early Baroque music, however, has withstood the test of time, and brass instrumentalists are performing transcriptions and arrangements of it to this day. In spite of this, the concept of sprezzatura that is so inherent to the practice of this music has been largely eclipsed by other aesthetics, most notably that of athleticism, or the prioritization of virtuosity and power over ease and grace. As an example of this aesthetic, I will play a short clip of a canzona by Gabrielli performed by the London Symphony Brass in 2005. Before going on, I will acknowledge that it is dangerous to make a blanket generalization about the stylistic practices of all modern brass groups. Indeed, that is not the purpose of this paper, and such a claim would be false. Recordings by ensembles such as the Meridian Arts Ensemble certainly display what could be considered sprezzatura in a modern sense. That said, an observation of Renaissance and early Baroque sound recordings on modern brass instruments from the 1950s through today reveals proportionally few attempts at historical style. In contrast, a parallel exploration of period instrument sound recordings reveals a divergent musical evolution, with athleticism giving way to sprezzatura and other historical concepts as musicians adjusted their performance practice in keeping with the latest research. Today, I will use recordings of Gabrielli's music as case studies for these two parallel developments in brass performance practice. Since the 1950s, brass players have prized transcriptions of Renaissance and early Baroque music for its idiomatic qualities. Edward Power Biggs, a champion of these transcriptions, claimed that, quote, obviously, the music calls for the brilliant sonority of brasses. The Philip Jones Brass Ensemble, founded in 1951, fulfilled Biggs's vision, producing recordings of Renaissance and early Baroque brass transcriptions through 1986. Here is a short clip of a Richard Carr from their 1967 collaboration with Dennis Stevens. It would be hard to argue that any other ensemble had such an influence on brass chamber music, but they were not alone. The New York Brass Ensemble, the American Brass Quintet, Edward Tarr's Brass Ensemble, and the Boston Brass, as well as brass sections from major symphonies throughout the United States and Europe, were all active in the movement to legitimize brass ensembles alongside string and woodwind chamber groups. As a result, recordings of Renaissance and Baroque brass, often with organ, proliferated through the 20th century. Today's study considers, among others, the arguable apex of these recordings, the Grammy Award-winning 1968 album, The Antiphonal Music of Gabrielli. This album is likely familiar to nearly every person present at today's symposium. It has been released no less than 9 times and is considered a tour de force of brass virtuosity. Athleticism dominates the recording's aesthetic. The players, members of the Cleveland, Chicago, and Philadelphia orchestras, prioritized flashy, fast-moving notes, thick sonorities, and, above all, sheer decibel power, a style which Robert Spreadling later dubbed the, quote, higher, faster, louder phenomenon. Here is an excerpt from that famous album.
Thank you.
the same time, proponents of period brass instruments were busy at work. One of the earliest recordings of Gabrielli performed on period brass is of a live performance of Orfeo by the Yale Collegium and the Vienna Philharmonic in 1954. There, the conductor, Paul Hindemith, inserted a piece from Sacre Symphoniae. This concert apparently inspired Arnicourt, who played in the performance and famously said that it affected him like a bolt of lightning. Two other early examples of Gabrielli recordings, which include period brass, are the 1960 release by the Orchestra of La Scola Cantorum and the 1962 New York Pro Musica record, Renaissance Festival Music. I'll play a couple of these clips now, and you'll probably notice that the playing style, with hard articulation and very little varying of inflection, does not yet differ so much from that of modern playing. It wasn't until the 1980s that playing styles between period and modern brass instrument groups truly diverged. Early brass enthusiasts will perhaps be familiar with the album Affetti Musicali, recorded in 1981 by a group of players at the Scola Cantorum. Two performers on the album, Bruce Dickey and Charles Tutte, would eventually go on to form Concerto Palatino and transform the landscape of historical performance practice on brass instruments. Bruce Dickey writes in the liner notes for this album, quote, instrumentalists were exploring equally the possibilities of the new affective vocal style and the idiomatic qualities of their instruments. Instrumentalists were to imitate the latest fashions of monodic singing. Dickey also acknowledges and indeed draws attention to the virtuosity of the repertoire, referring to the, quote, Venetian love of brilliance, the astonishing degree of the trombone's agility in the 17th century, and the cornet's, quote, ability to imitate the human voice and its agility in playing rapid divisions. However, it is notable that even in this liner text, agility is still framed within the overarching musical concepts of vocality and expressivity, two qualities inherent in the sprezzatura of the stile moderno that are prioritized above virtuosity and power. I'm going to play a short excerpt from the record that reflects this, briefly straying from Gabrielli to Picchi to demonstrate the historical techniques that Dickey describes. I will follow this with a piece from Concerto Palatino's 1990 album, Italian Music for Cornets and Trombones. Concerto Palatino's groundbreaking recordings established new standards of period brass playing based on both historical evidence and its practical application to period instruments. And this in turn inspired a new generation of performers who specialized in period brass, including ultramontano, dark horse consort, ensemble in alto, and countless others. These players continue to develop their techniques today, taking inspiration both from their predecessor's sound concepts and, perhaps even more importantly, their curiosity for historical, organological, and practical research that was at the heart of this new school of brass playing. To demonstrate this, here is a video of Dark Horse Consort playing Canzone Primi Toni at the Chiesa di San Rocco in 2020. Brass ensemble was also evolving during this time period. The roots put in place by Philip Jones had taken hold, and an enthusiasm for Renaissance and early Baroque music had proliferated among professional brass players. As period brass practice followed Dickey's lead, modern brass ensembles were simultaneously finding parallel musical paths in athleticism, often transferring contemporary orchestral and soloistic techniques to earlier styles of music. Instrument development, orchestral playing traditions, extant method books, and conservatory pedagogy all likely contributed to the initial development of this aesthetic. Few could argue that historical techniques are commonly taught as part of a mainstream orthodox pedagogy, or what Herbert calls, quote, the linear and the pragmatic. While a complete generalization would be unfair, recordings of Renaissance and early Baroque music by brass faculty at major conservatories nevertheless prioritized athleticism as a dominant musical aesthetic through the 20th century. Indeed, the influence of the powerful 1960s sound concept is widely apparent even into the 21st century. As a case study, I will turn to a 2015 album that was conceived as an homage to the 1968 recording. The newly named National Brass Ensemble consisted of players from the same three orchestras, with additions from the Los Angeles, San Francisco, Detroit, and Boston symphonies. These musicians likewise taught at major conservatories throughout North America. Trombonist Tim Higgins had explored facsimiles of Gabrielli's Sacre Symphoniae in order to create updated editions for the project. Higgins took seriously many aspects of performance practice, particularly the aesthetic of vocality that is so central to achieving sprezzatura. As he explained, quote, I spent time speaking and singing the Latin text aloud and translated these sounds into brass articulations. The notation that I ended up using accommodates the vocal nature of the music without forcing the brass instruments to sound unauthentic. In spite of this, side-by-side comparisons of the 1968 and 2015 recordings reveal few changes in intuitive stylistic choices made by the players themselves. Higgins's portrayal of Renaissance vocal style through modern articulation markings, barrings, and compressed note values brought the motets closer to a stylistic ideal. But the players frequently reverted to the power-driven, virtuosic aesthetic of the original 1968 during the canzoni, which have no text in the original parts and no written indications for inflection. As such, athleticism continued to dominate the recording in cases where it was not tamed by specific markings in the edition. One can determine then that the performance practice of the 1968 recording not only remained through the natural unconscious emulation of its style, but that this homage is itself a kind of historical performance, a new oral tradition that deliberately emulates the athletic aesthetic of the late 1960s. Where does this leave us? Period instrumentalists primarily used traditional historical methodologies and research through performance to develop their practice. And modern brass players used an essentially oral tradition, engendered and solidified by the recordings of Philip Jones and professional orchestral brass sections. In light of this, I will pose a final question for today. Has this divide ever been bridged? Is it even possible? To answer this, I will refer to one more case study. The liner notes for the HR Brass album Venetian Brass of 1992, directed by Edward Tarr, notably state that the recording, quote, is perhaps the first attempt to rehearse this music with modern instruments while maintaining the performance practices of their time. This becomes clear with the adoption of an organ positive, which is played continuously basso seguente, and is a real challenge for any brass ensemble. The measure is emphasized with a distinct differentiation between lighter and heavier notes. The tonality is more dynamic and slight by using the mezza di voce and improvisations with ornaments, as they were taught by Dalla Casa and Bassano. The clip we just heard clearly reveals real attempts at varied articulation, vocal affects, and most of all, grace, elements of sprezzatura that fulfill Zenobi's description of ideal performance in 1600. This proves three key points. First, Edward Tarr and his ensemble were well aware of developments in historical period instrument performance. Second, they wished to integrate these developments into their own modern brass playing. And third, in spite of the physical differences of the instruments, they recognized that this integration was possible. In spite of this, these aesthetic principles have yet to be fully integrated into most mainstream brass performance, perhaps because integrated recordings such as these are so rare. As a result, the pursuit of historical performance practice has remained largely relegated to period instrument specialists. The proliferation and popularity of more mainstream recordings that prioritize athleticism have created a firmly entrenched pedagogical and musical tradition for modern brass players, a kind of meta-performance practice in which sound recordings serve as a modern oral tradition that continues to influence how brass players think about performance practice. At this final juncture, I will refer to a fascinating exchange between Richard Cheatham, Douglas Hedwig, and Jeffrey Nussbaum from an interview in 1997. Regarding Renaissance and early Baroque music, Cheatham says that, quote, "There is no reason why one can't play this music in an informed way on modern instruments. It's again a matter of attitude. If I were to go in a modern brass ensemble, there is no reason why I couldn't play this Bach 36 exactly the same way as I play my sackbut. Obviously, the weight of sound would be different, the clarity of articulation reduced, but musically, it's entirely possible. Likewise, someone such as David Staff could do the same on a B-flat trumpet. Imagine what a modern brass ensemble playing Gabrielli could sound like with the right players. Whether this will ever actually happen, of course, is an entirely different matter." I will respond to Mr. Cheatham's ponderings with one final recording, a Gabrielli canzona performed by the Royal College of Music and Juilliard School Brass in 2017, 20 years after this interview was completed. I will say little about this recording, except to quote its producer, Jonathan Freeman Atwood, who sought through this project to discover what he called, in capital letters, a third way. Have the traditions converged? Is a new bridge between modern and period practice beginning to be built? I'll let you decide.